$167 billion they will spend on this. So it is absolutely huge. It doesn't just flow, it actually drops. And this is the thing I love about this project. So it's a massive Grand Canyon and it drops about 2,000 meters over 30 miles. And that is where they're going to harness the flow and the energy of the water.
Hello and welcome to The Climate Question from the BBC World Service. I'm Greg Jackson.
And I'm Jordan Dunbar. Now, you'll have heard climate scientists warn us, if we want to avoid the worst effects of climate change, we need to move away from fossil fuels and to renewable energy. That's your solar, wind and hydroelectric power, amongst others.
One country installing renewables at a record rate is China. Did you know that by the end of the decade, almost half of the world's renewables will be in this Asian powerhouse?
And one major renewable it uses is hydropower. And China is not a place shy of having big ideas. And they're planning to build a mega dam. It is going to be the world's biggest hydroelectric dam.
And so our climate question is, why is China building the world's biggest hydroelectric dam? Jordan, you visited some dams before, right? In
Did
Thailand?
Did I ever? Yeah, I got to go to Pumipon Dam, which at one point was Thailand's mega dam. It was built decades ago, but it absolutely transformed the economy. It was the first massive dam that they built. And the reason we went there was to see what happens when dams start to run out of water, which is something lots of places around the world will experience. Because this dam absolutely transformed Thailand's economy. It gave it lots of electricity through hydropower. It held a big reservoir of water, which stopped flooding. And it also meant irrigation, so you could have extra harvests for the farmers. So at the time, it was really seen as a miracle dam. But as time has gone on, problems have started to come up. This dam is a tiny, tiny, tiny toddler compared to the mega dams that we're going to be looking at, but it was absolutely transformational. So they can have big pros and big cons.
Right. Well, let's hear from the BBC's China correspondent, Laura Bicker. How are you?
I am very well. It's a very rainy evening here in Beijing, but lovely to talk to you.
Hi, Laura. It's good to see you again. It struck me that every time we talk to you, it's always about something huge. I don't think we've ever talked about something small scale, be it solution, problem or issue. It's always absolutely massive.
Well, welcome to China. Everything here, they like to put things on a huge scale. And this is no different.
Well, let's start. Tell me, where is this hydroelectric dam being built? Where is it in China?
So it's way in Tibet. So it's in right in the Himalayas. So the roof of the world. And one of the most contentious areas, you could say, when it comes to China, because China annexed Tibet in 1950. And since then, it has been pumping money into infrastructure projects in Tibet to try to ensure that it kind of amalgamates with the rest of the country. And so when it comes to a project like this, not only can it argue that it will be providing electricity for Tibet, it will be providing jobs, construction jobs, good high-paying jobs. But it's right on that Himalayan plateau. So you're looking at high mountains where the glaciers melt and form these huge rivers. And it's right near the India-Bangladesh borders as well. So when it comes to how contentious it is, it's not just about within China, it's also with its neighbours.
Right, well, I've been hyping this dam and its size up from the start of the programme. Give me the numbers. You said they've been pumping money in. Give us the stats.
World's largest infrastructure project, $167 billion they will spend on this. So it is absolutely huge. But the other numbers, so this is about a 2,000 kilometre river. That's just about, what, 1,200 miles? And it doesn't just flow, it actually drops. And this is the thing I love about this project. So it's a massive Grand Canyon and it drops about 2,000 metres over 30 miles. And that is where they're going to harness the flow and the energy of the water. Now, they seem to have learned from previous projects. So what they're not going to kind of try to hold the water back, they're also going to tunnel through this canyon. And basically, it's less of a dam and more of a tunnel. And that is how this cascade of really kind of trying to control the water and use the energy of the water, that is how they are going to generate electricity. Now, if we look at the world's largest dam currently, that's the Three Gorges Dam that sits on the Yangtze River. That provides electricity, just looking down at my notes, for 40 million Chinese people and households. So this one, they say, could provide electricity for 3 to 4 times that. So that's how big this dam and the potential for energy supply is.
And what's the official reason being given for building it? Is it climate reasons that the Chinese government have said they need to build something so absolutely massive?
This is about climate resilience. China is determined to be in charge of its own destiny when it comes to generating electricity. It is a real problem, and that's one of the reasons why for years it has relied on coal. Not just, obviously having their own coal mines, but importing it. So China relies on importing oil and importing gas from Russia. But in the last 5 to 10 years, things have changed. I mean, this year in May, for instance, when it comes to the likes of solar and wind power, they have installed around 100 solar panels a second in May. That's how far they are pushing this renewable project in China. So when it comes to solar, to wind, to hydroelectricity, they see this as a way of becoming self-sufficient, of not having to rely on importing oil and gas and coal from anywhere else, or generating or building new coal-fired power stations. Now, they are still building more coal-fired power stations than anyone else on the planet. But they are also building and creating more renewable projects than anyone else on the planet. And this one will be the biggest. And they are indeed the biggest hydropower nation. Around 18% of their current electricity generation comes from hydropower. And with this one, one of the key issues is they'll be running this kind of massive line all the way from Tibet to the south, to the likes of Guangdong, Macau, Hong Kong. Now, these are really highly populated areas. Guangdong is important because it's the hub, it's the factory of the world. If you looked around your home, there's probably something in there that has come from Guangdong and been made in Guangdong, from your sofa to your perhaps a kettle. It produces all of these major things, but that is electricity thirsty. It really needs power. And so this dam will have a massive pipeline that will run all the way from the dam to Guangdong to help power this region.
100 solar panels a second is a mind-boggling amount of solar panels. I cannot get my head around that. But you mentioned resilience there, Laura. And I'm interested because last week on the programme, we heard about how Pakistan is just also in the Himalayas. A lot of the rivers are fed there by melting glaciers. And that puts them at risk for things like floods, but also droughts. And I'm wondering, given that this dam is in a similar area, how resilient it will be if it's also facing melting glaciers? You know, how reliable will that flow of water be?
And that is one of the big issues that China cannot answer. And we're not able to ask these questions right now. And I think it's one of the other main issues for China's neighbours, the likes of India, the likes of Bangladesh, both of whom have raised serious concerns about this hydropower project. Now, one of the things that they've kept saying, or certainly the neighbouring province has called it a water bomb, they believe that China would have the ability to harness that water and prevent the water flowing into their countries, thereby creating a drought. And we've seen the likes of this. I've travelled right along the Mekong River, which flows all the way through China, again comes from the Himalayas, comes all the way through China into Cambodia, Laos and Thailand. It is an important river for millions of people. And not just because of its water supply, but also because of its plentiful supply of fish. And the key thing with these dams, although they've built fish ladders to try to help migrating fish, it's all about the silt. It's all about the sediment that sits at the bottom of the rivers. Now, it doesn't sound sexy. It makes the rivers brown. Everybody goes, what's silt got to do with it? But that silt is so important because it feeds the ecosystem. It feeds the plankton. It feeds the fish. And that is what is missing. When you dam the river, that silt is unable to flow to the areas where it's needed, to the areas where fish thrive.
You mentioned a neighbouring country called it a water ticking time bomb. What has the government said to that sort of concern about controlling of water?
China has said that this is an ecological project, that they are looking at these concerns, that there is no need to be worried, that this is the project of the century, that there will be benefits for everybody, that it will prevent flooding in various regions. And of course, they do say they have learned lessons. And I think so they have dismissed the concerns of India, dismissed the concerns of Bangladesh. And it does look like this project is certainly now going ahead. So I think when it comes to this kind of statement, China will not bend.
I mean, we've touched upon the incredible amount of renewable energy that's being installed in China. But I'm interested, what impact has that had on electricity prices? Are your bills cheaper, Laura, as a result?
My bills are cheaper. As a result, so actually in certain areas, I hate to boast, I hate to brag, but yeah, my bills are a lot cheaper. So I think it depends on which region you live in, but your electricity bills here in China are coming down between 2 to 11%. I think in Guangdong this year, the province that I talked about, this industrial hub, the factory of the world, I think it's come down by about 8% in the last year alone. So the renewables that they're pushing towards are having an effect. I do have to keep emphasising there are still a large number of coal power stations on the side of all these renewables, which many environmentalists are concerned that they're still building these power stations. But on the other side, I mean, when you travel from province to province, you see fields of solar panels. You see them building huge wind turbines. They've even got this new floating solar panel site on the water. So they are trying and experimenting and doing what they think is necessary to ensure that China has a source of electricity, especially renewables, to be more self-reliant in the future.
Right. OK. And I think the reduction in the cost of coal is also contributing, right, as alongside the renewables to the lowering of electricity prices. Yeah. Laura, I have to ask you, when you were talking about fish ladders, I went into like a weird little mind.
Yes.
And imagined fish with their little fins climbing up a ladder. I'm imagining that's not what a fish ladder is. Have you seen one?
Listen, if you want to imagine a fish ladder, they're there and they're kind of climbing up. That is up to you. No, they're not like that. Some scientists say these fish ladders, these almost like, it's not like the cat flap, but it's similar. If you look at your house, if you're saying hi, cat, come in, come out, it's a bit like that where the fish can find their way up, because obviously when they jump, they are able to kind of land and get through a river. So it's basically enabling them to carry out their migration. But yeah, I mean, if you want to imagine them with their little fins carrying up ladders, that's a good
I'm
image as well.
I'm thinking of like a water slide, but, you know, almost like a water tube that they can swim up, or jumping from terrace to terrace. Jordan, have you got all sorts of weird mental imagery like
needs
me?
Needs a new name. Catfish flap.
Catfish flap. Laura Bicker, the BBC's senior China correspondent. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Laura. Hopefully speak to you soon. Bye-bye.
Great to speak to you too. Bye-bye.
Bye. I did not expect to talk about fish ladders so much today.
No, not with the BBC senior China correspondent.
No, but what was really interesting about what Laura said is that China wasn't willing to comment on how resilient this dam was, because we know as the climate changes, rainfall patterns are going to change. Some places will be drier and have less rain, experience drought. Other places will be getting more rain, more rainfall, and therefore the risk of floods is going to increase. So actually, when you're building and spending billions, hundreds of billions in this case, of dollars on a project, you need to make sure that there's going to be enough water.
But it's going to last.
Yeah, in 30, 60, 50, I don't know how long dams last, 100 years' time.
Particularly if you're relying on it. So one of the reasons we were in Thailand was to look at that exact point. So this dam, Pumipon, completely transformed the economy. You know, for decades it had been working well, but because of unpredictable rainfall and because of drought, the water levels were going down. And it's quite an old dam, so it's not making as much electricity as it needed, and it's not doing as much irrigation. So anyway, they have a plan, which was part of the reason we're there, and that was to take water from a river across a mountain range, which during rainy season floods loads, so they say too much water, drill through this mountain, bring a pipeline, and then fill up in the rainy season this dam with the water. So basically diverting a river to try and move it about, which again, hugely technical. I don't know what fish ladders or what they have to think about in that, drilling through a mountain.
That is going to be one water slide for a fish, isn't it? Straight through the mountain.
But it's so technical and expensive, and so many different regions that rely on hydropower are experiencing less and less water. So while it might be good for the economy, and on the one hand look good for the climate, environmentally and the long term, it's a bit more dicey.
As you were talking, I was actually reminded that some people are thinking that hydroelectric dams could actually be batteries.
Mm.
And so perhaps if the water is running out, what you do is you take the water that's run through and you pump it back up and you hide it behind the dam, and then you run it back through when, say, the sun isn't shining and you haven't got solar power, or the wind isn't blowing and you haven't got wind power. And that solves some of the intermittency problems we have around those power sources and gives you almost like a battery. I wonder if anything like that could ever be considered.
Yeah, and certainly dams and mega dams in particular aren't going away, because Ethiopia, you know, they heard what China was doing. They said, hold my drill. They've just opened the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam, which is the biggest hydroelectric dam in Africa, $5 billion. It's more than doubled Ethiopia's electricity capacity to the point where they're going to be exporting. So they've made over $400 million. And exporting to different countries. So it's not just going to be for Ethiopia, like the megadam in China. It's actually could power entire Eastern African countries.
Yeah, I remember we made a program about this, I think 3 or 4 years ago. And what I remember is that it's also hugely controversial because Ethiopia sits upstream of Egypt and what was the other?
Sudan.
There we go. You remember.
Top of the Nile.
And there's that worry about what's going to happen to
exactly
their water.
The same in China.
Yeah, yeah, it's a really big issue, isn't it? I think especially as our climate changes and water sources become more variable as a result. But I think hydro does play this really interesting role. You know, I talked about this intermittency problem of wind and solar, but actually the good thing about hydropower is that it can always be on. It acts in the same way that conventional fossil fuels like coal, oil and gas, I'll get there eventually, can always be on. And it's the same with geothermal, and it's the same with nuclear, these low carbon sources that can always be on and provide what experts call base load power.
Well, when I was in Thailand, I had the nicest gesture anyone's ever done for me before. Mm-hmm. I got to see that base load power. The engineer took us down into the James Bond like concrete caverns, and they flip a switch and the turbine starts spinning, the water goes through, and that is like flipping on a switch, just turning on all of that electricity, hundreds of megawatts immediately.
What does that sound like?
Really loud. Really hot, really loud, really intense. I think I squealed for quite a while, which the engineer found quite odd because they're every day. But it gives you a sense of what you were saying, which is like if you need loads of power instantly, you can just flick it on. Doesn't matter if it's not windy. Doesn't matter if it's not sunny. You can just turn it on at any point.
Wow. All right. Well, on that mind-blowing note, we shall say goodbye. Don't forget, before you do go, subscribe to the BBC World Service YouTube channel so you don't miss a thing.
Or if you have a climate question of your own, you can comment it below and we'll try and answer it in a future show.